Welcome back to Matter of Fact. A little-known piece of history is coming to life on stage. The Stono Rebellion of 1739 in South Carolina was one of the largest slave revolts in our nation. An estimated 35 to 50 slaves were killed. That bitter tragedy gave rise to a resilient and glorious sound that can still be heard in modern music today. That story's being told as part of a touring production called Drumfolk. Here's our special correspondent, Joie Chen, with a preview.
Deep in the marsh grass, you can almost hear it. Here, where the Stono River runs down to the Edisto, is where a group of Africans, enslaved by British colonists, fought for their freedom. In the largest uprising of colonial times, the Stono Rebellion of 1739.
The Stono Rebellion was not the biggest rebellion. It may not have been the first of enslaved people, of enslaved Africans.
Yes.
But you're arguing that it really changed America.
Yeah, I will say it really did change America. So to me, the Stono Rebellion is an amazing piece of history in terms of Africans fighting against the institution of slavery.
Now, nearly three centuries later, what happened at Stono serves as inspiration for Brian Williams' new production, Drumfolk, and in every move of the dance company he founded, Step Afrika. We visited the company in rehearsal and met two artists for whom the work touches close to home. Dustin Prelo plays the lead, Jemmy.
It's about where I'm from. Being from there, I really feel a sense of responsibility just to portray the scenarios in the right light.
He and company dancer Jonathan McClinton Smith are native South Carolinians and may even have had ancestors in the Lowcountry when the Stono Rebellion took place. But it's a history they didn't learn about in school.
You learn talking points, or you learn a very whitewashed and happy version of history, but I didn't learn something like this, something that predates the Civil War by over 100 years.
The short version, Jemmy, an enslaved African, led others in a failed attempt to reach freedom in Spanish-held Florida. In the aftermath of their courageous bid for freedom, and directly because of it, came a draconian clampdown, the Negro Act of 1740.
What did that Negro Act of 1740 prohibit?
Africans could no longer learn to read. They could no longer learn to write. They could not wear clothing above their stature. And Africans lost the right to use the drum. The drum was made an illegal weapon, if you will.
The drum?
The drum.
Was made illegal?
Made illegal.
Silenced in an effort to keep the Africans from communicating and organizing. Just imagine how devastating it was to lose their social network.
So if you were to take phones or Facebook or any social media platform away from the masses, people would be at a pause. They wouldn't know what to do, similar to the way that the drums were taken away. They had to regroup and figure out something else.
That something else was a way to keep the beat alive, using their own bodies as instruments.
So these are one of the first workings of this inward percussive element. And so you'll see—
They took the drums away.
Right, they took them away, but we still found ways to put them inside of everything we did as well.
The beat.
Yes, yes.
The beat never stopped. It pulsed through the ring shout, first performed in black churches of the Sea Islands, later to the hambone and the juba. It's echoed in tap dancing, even in today's beatboxing. And in the precision of stepping, the percussive dance tradition of historically black fraternities and sororities. To these artists, the Stono Rebellion and the colonists' fierce retribution marked the moment when the enslaved Africans created a new culture in America.
It laid the foundation for what would become African Americans and African American culture.
And the foundation of a legacy that steps forward to this day. For Matter of Fact, I'm Joie Chen in Bethesda, Maryland.